I think it was Bill Clinton, the Treasury Secretary.
Okay, thank you.
If you were reincarnated, you'd probably come back as a foreign conference, because it's the only thing that can make the president of the United States kneel. And I always thought if I was going to come back, I'd have to come back as USBC, because we're in foreign conference for that reason. There's lots of really interesting looking stuff on the USBC, right?
Yes.
See the word amigo? Pretty easy other side.
Yeah.
And where is the? There we go. Thank you very much indeed. You're an absolute lifesaver. Don't forget to take this away at the end. Well, good morning, everybody. I hope you've all been having fun here at Maker Faire. My name's Evan, and I run a company based in Cambridge, just been around for a little while, called Raspberry Pi. And I'm here to talk to you today about silicon and some chips. Well, we've been designing silicon chips for over half a decade, I think for a little while. That was one of our best kept secrets, was the Raspberry Pi. We hired all these people, we actually hired a bunch of basic engineers from Raspberry Pi, asked them not to update their LinkedIn pages so that nobody knew we were designing chips. We've been doing it for a little bit over half a decade. We launched our first chip, which was called RP2040, it's a microcontroller. We launched that at the start of 2021. And in the 2 years since, we've been completely astonished by the uses that makers have found for our product. All the way from, I guess, music synthesis, computer gaming, from building custom keyboards to building industrial controllers. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about a few of those use cases. But first, I thought I should give you some background on the history of microcontrollers at Raspberry Pi and some of the thought processes that went into the design of RP2040. We're best known, of course, at Raspberry Pi for our Linux-based computers. But since 2013, since about a year after we launched our first computer, we've also been designing accessories for those computers. Now, almost every one of those accessories incorporates a microcontroller. And almost every one of those microcontrollers, interestingly, turns out to be an Atmel on that microchip from 80 ton or 80 mega. We really adore, Raspberry Pi really does love AVR8. So why is that? What do we like in particular about the AVR8 architecture? Well, four things, I guess. First of all, they're cheap to buy. They have low price points, and low price points allow us to build low-cost accessories. And low-cost accessories for our low-cost computers enable our mission of democratizing access to technology. And they're not just cheap to buy, they're also cheap to use. They come in very simple packages. They don't require a lot of external components. And they let us implement our designs on the very lowest cost PCB technologies. They're also very simple to program. They're modern orthogonal, they're not hexed. I think it's one of, you know, you can sum this up as it's not a hex. It has a modern orthogonal risk instruction set. That turns into good compiler support, that translates into good compiler support. And it also means that it's a very rewarding, enjoyable assembly language programming experience for the little pieces of code that really need to run at high speed. And finally, they're great for interfacing. They run at a relatively high clock speed, I mean 20 megahertz, relatively high clock speed for an old microcontroller. And they provide deterministic low latency. They provide low latency, deterministic single cycle access to the I/O pins. And what this allows us to do is to fold what would otherwise be considered hardware functionality in with our software and device and reduce the components that come on board. I think it's the last of these that proved most helpful to us, most influential, and most helpful to us when we were designing our accessories, and most influential on us when we were conceptualizing our P2040 and we were thinking of our first microcontroller as some sort of super-powered, modernized API. I'll give you just one example. The SensePad here has this grid of 64 RGB LEDs, and it's not using a particularly fancy controller to control those LEDs. Cheapest, simplest driver to farm. It's able to do that because the AVR is powerful enough and deterministic enough that we're able to generate all of the PWM control waveforms for that grid in handwritten AVR assembly. So if you're using a component like a microcontroller at scale, you know, we sell millions and millions and millions of Raspberry Pis, millions of accessories every year. If you're using a component like a microcontroller at scale, I think it's natural to start to wonder whether you can do better yourself, or you can make a better version of this thing if you're using. So by 2017, we'd actually already hired a small JIT team in Cambridge. And we had some experience with other people's microcontrollers, and we had some ideas heavily influenced by AVR8 about what sort of features we'd like to incorporate into a microcontroller of our own. So how did we go about turning those ideas into reality? Well, the JIT team that we'd hired weren't hired to build microcontrollers. They were actually intended to be helping at Broadcom to make better application processors to go into the big and of course this effort would eventually result in the 2711 application processor that went into Raspberry Pi 4 from 2019 onwards. But alongside this work, the interesting thing about chip work is it's not continuous, it's quite bursty. And alongside this main task for the team, we were able to find a little time to put together a prototype microcontroller. Now we built it around a pair of ARM's smallest and most efficient core. Now this A0, the A0 that we take down in 2018, actually different from the final RP2040 number. I cheated in, it's actually the diagram. There is no diagram. For example, project, there is no equivalent diagram for the A0 RP2040. The A0 did differ from the final RP2040 in a number of ways. And in particular, we did have a go when people ask us, why doesn't RP2040 have flash on die? And the answer is, we did put flash on die on A0, and it was a really horrible, terrible experience. So it did have flash on the die. But even at this point, a number of the key design elements were already present. So we have two identical cores up here. We have this symmetrical cluster called X0 pluses. One of those was intended nominally in our minds. One of them was intended to run application code. And the other was there to emulate peripherals. That sort of feeling that you can, a processor that's sufficiently close to the I/O pins on the chip can be used to pretend that it is actually peripheral. We decided on a high clock speed. Well, high clock speed for AVR8 means 20 megahertz, high clock speed for us on 40 nanometers processor, and then between 100 and 150 megahertz. But we were able to retain single cycle access to PPIO. So you see these cores here, and there's a block called SIO, which is available to them in a single cycle. You can do reasonable stuff in a single cycle from the processor, and that's connected straight out to the PPIO here. That's a really important part of the peripheral emulation function of the cores on RP2 series chips. We included what we call a fully connected crossbar. We have this bus fabric here. This is a fully connected crossbar. What this means is we have four bus masters, the two processors, and the read and write channels of the DMA. We have a number of memories down here. We have banked memory down here. And as long as these masters are addressing different banks of memory, they can run at full speed independently. Obviously, that's important generically for getting good performance out of the system. It also means if you are using one of your processors to emulate a peripheral, then the other processor, which is running application code, can't get in there and interfere with the operation. But finally, you know, this is a lot of SRAM. We put a lot of SRAM on this design in particular, a lot of SRAM when people ship Cortex-M0 plus microcontrollers. Often they'll put kilobytes or tens of kilobytes of memory in. Even at this point, and you'll see in a moment that we went past this later on, even at this point we decided we were going to put 100 tons of. It also included a very early version of PIO, the Programmable I/O Subsystem, which I guess has become the defining feature, the differentiating feature of ARP2040. We'd originally intended this as an alternative way to build some of the very simplest software referrals. The very simplest software referrals would be implemented on PIO, slightly more complicated software referrals would be implemented on ARP1. It did feel like it was worth trying to offload some really, really simply and building a UART. Maybe we could build something which could be used to offload some simple serial devices. But over time, we added features to the point where PIO has now been successfully used to implement standards and smart versus SPIO, DPI, and Canvas. So that's A0, came back, it worked. The flash was really awful. And this is B0, this is the thing we actually shipped away. It shouldn't be B1 or B2, we shipped small revisions of this. So B0 taken out to TSMC in early 2020, so that's kind of talking about squeaking out the door before everything went wrong. Taken out to TSMC in 2020 was safely snug in the foundry while everything was going wrong out into the outside world. Came back in the middle of the year, worked extremely well. Almost every aspect changed a little bit since A0. But I guess we can call out three major improvements, sort of changes, improvements from my point of view. We replaced the on-die flash with a Qt5 interface for off-die flash. That experience, that nightmare experience that we had with 40 nanometer eFlash made us very, very happy about outsourcing that flash areas. We've grown our, you can see these big areas here. These are SRAMs. These are the 4B, 64K SRAM banks. So we grew our memory, we grew our on-chip SRAMs in 264K, which is 256K in four of these 64K banks, and then these two little memories down here. These are the 4K memories, they're intended to hold stacks and high-performance memories. We added a couple of neat features. We added something we call bank mode, which gives developers precise control over where their code, where their data is across those memories. And we also introduced something called stripe mode, which if people want to work a little bit less hard, they just want to benefit from the very high aggregate bandwidth of all of these memories, but without doing all of the detailed work involved in saying, oh, my code's going there, and what's my data going over there. You can actually stripe the memory across them. And finally, we added support for mass storage device class. We have a USB 1 controller and file here. We added support for mass storage device class and the UF2 file format into our ROM bootloader. And that means that uploading a binary on one of these devices became as simple as plugging it into a PC and then dragging the file. The chip team in 2020 was almost unrecognizable compared to the 2017 era predecessor that we started work on the A0 step. We hired a lot more front-end engineers. These are the people who designed the chip at a high level in parallel. We hired verification engineers, because it's always nice to know your chip is going to work before you spend $1 million on taking it out. And we had a back-end engineering team too. These are the people who take that Verilog and turn it into this, turn it into a picture, turn it into something that actually manufactures that. B0 is actually the first chip to be implemented completely in-house. And we also invested a lot in software. We built the first version of the Pico SDK and in documentation. So we've written about 1,000 pages of data sheet and a bunch of other supporting material. So by the end of 2020, ARP2040 was in mass production. We had samples with partners. We actually went out to a number of our friends and gave them early access to the ARP2040 silicon to build their own products. And Raspberry Pi Pico, our first party product, was ready for launch. But in getting there, we realized that actually we were missing one thing, and that's what we would call an operations team. Now, ops is the catch-all term for all of the work that still remains to be done once chip development notion comes to an end. I sort of think of chip development as being finished once you have one of these, once you have a picture, once you have a GDS and packaging design. In fact, there's a heap of other work that needs to be done before you can ship and needs to continue to be done while you're shipping in order to ensure that you can ship safely. I've listed a few of these here. Product and package qualification, you're making sure that these devices are going to continue to work when they're in the field for a long period of time. Overseeing the production and shipment of silicon wafers in the foundry, particularly challenging as we were in the middle of the silicon supply chain crisis as we were trying to ramp this product. Arranging for parts to be assembled from the wafers that we've got from the foundry, tested, put onto reels, and then dry packed for distribution. Monitoring yield at each step of this process, each of these things can go wrong. When you stack up a bunch of even very reliable processes that have 90 to 100% yield, over the course of that, you can end up with 60, 70% yield, which would be disastrous if they're not. And most importantly, failure analysis, analysing failed parts of the return to the field. Now, we're very fortunate that has not actually happened yet, but it's very likely that at some point someone will find a thing they can do to our chip which disturbs it. And when that happens, we're going to want to be able to take those failed parts of the field, understand what's going on. We actually outsource, you can outsource all of this work. You can outsource almost everything. We actually outsourced a lot of this work in the first year of IP 2040, but really there is no substitute for doing it yourself. And today we have quite a substantial ops team to occupy. It didn't just, and that didn't just improve our product quality, it also gave us some new avenues for cost reduction. One of the big goals with IP 2040 is to build a very, very well it might be a little while before, we like vertical integration, we like to do things ourselves. I think it's going to be a while before we open our first 40 nanometer fab. I think it's even actually going to be a while before we own our own chip packaging. But what we do actually now own is this thing, which is chip testicle. This is the thing that takes the package apart, determines whether that part is good, and then reels it, or decides it's bad. And I do think that this kind of obsession with vertical integration, this obsession with insourcing, is kind of one of the things that sets us apart from other vendors. What we've ended up with is an incredibly low cost, incredibly high, relatively high performance, and very, very reliable device. It's like that. Because we really do try and do everything ourselves. We don't always succeed, but we do try and do everything ourselves. We build our own silicon IP, we write our own design automation tools, we use the IP and the tools to build our own chips, to design complete chips ourselves. We manage our own operations, and to the greatest extent possible, where it can be done at the cost of hundreds of thousands rather than tens of billions of dollars, we try and own the equipment ourselves. We try and write great code. I'm sure everyone in this group tries to write great code. We write a lot of documentation. And we will sell people our chips directly. You can come to our website and you can buy a real or 500 chips directly from us, and we don't want to know what you do. One of the enormous, I think it is a scourge, certainly, of the high-end chip industry, this idea of opportunity qualification, that you don't have to just have to want a chip, you have to convince the person who sells the chip that they should sell the chip. You never have to convince us that we should sell it in our chip. So that being said, although we don't care what people do, we do actually often, after the fact, find out what people have done with our chips. So as promised, I'm just going to give you a few little examples. And each of these four are the four examples, and each of them, I think, leans on a different facet of the RP2040 design. And each of them, in a sense, I guess, has forced us to reconsider what we've actually built with RP2040, which we originally had conceptualized as just being a microcontroller. Well, first of all, maybe RP2040 is a DSP. It was never really intended to be a digital signal processing workhorse, but we do have two cores. They're both clocked at 133 megahertz. They can perform one multiplication or addition per cycle. So we can do over a quarter of a billion integer operations a second. And as we thought, we can't have this really strange niche. I mean, it is a genuine niche of the product in audio synthesis. This product here is called Wobbler 2. They're all wonderfully named and quite beautiful Wobbler 2. This is not rocket science in the Netherlands. In a similar vein, we also find people using our product to run inference at the edge, to run tiny ML machine learning inference at the edge. Really, running neural network models is a matter of doing large numbers of dot products per dollar. And this is somewhere where, again, RP2040 turns out to be surprisingly compelling. Well, so make this a DSP, or maybe we build a keyboard controller. We have USB support because we needed a simple way to get data on and off the device. And I guess, possibly also for me in the back of my mind, I was hoping that people might use our microcontroller to build little programmable general purpose computers in the same way that I had used an ADR back in 2006 to build the very first prototype of something you might consider to be a Raspberry Pi. So we included USB host support, which is a comparative rarity in the microcontroller space, specifically to support driving a keyboard in that application. But the standout use case, I think, the USB on Raspberry Pi has actually been at the other end of that table, with people building their own custom keyboards and game controllers. This is a close-up of a Japanese, really beautiful Japanese PCB design for Raspberry Pi 2040 keyboard. We've had the RP2040, GP2040 GameCast firmware appeared about a year ago, and again about a year ago, the QMK project introduced RP2040 support to its own keyboard firmware. It's really taken that trend to the next level. We're seeing new designs almost every day now, particularly popular in Japan. So if I go on Twitter in the morning, obviously, if you're on Twitter in the morning, people have been awake in Japan for 8 hours. It seems like most of what we've been doing during those 8 hours. We've got a very positive, very negative effect on Japanese person as a product. Okay, well, let me use a keyboard controller. Maybe it's a CPLD. We have this PIO subsystem in the chip. The PIO and the DMA controllers, they were designed to emulate low-speed digital peripherals, and they were supposed to just handle the low-level input and output tasks, the kind of bit bashing tasks, while leaving any kind of high-level semantic operations to be executed on one of the ARM cores. But since launch, people have been steadily finding ways to make steadily more complex systems purely out of by sticking together PIO and DMA. I've got a few favorite examples. One of them, this is the GB Interceptor by Sebastian Stacks. This sits between your original Game Boy and its cartridge. I'm actually intercepting the lane to recreate the screen data out here over the USB, and it feeds it out as an MJPEG. It streams your data out to your PC as an MJPEG, and it does a lot of the MJPEG encoding. It's a hack, right? It actually just uses the DC components in JPEG, but it actually does most of that. In a similar vein, this chap from Kevin Vance's been able to build a Commodore 64 ROM cartridge, which handles all of the latching and addresses the local data, and then returning the data to the Commodore 64 data bus. And it does all of that. Using chained PIO, chained DMA. And then probably the last one, this thing called DMA CPU that Bruce Land of Cornell did, which implements a complete general purpose CPU, kind of a broadly actually AVR-8 equivalent, kind of like a 10 megahertz. Processor, 10 megahertz, fairly reduced instruction set processor, entirely using chain DMA blocks. And really what this is doing, what these projects are doing, is they're just edging ARP in 2014 into the space. This thing is not going to replace CTLDs, it's not going to replace FPGAs, but it's starting to edge ARP in 2014 into that kind of through logic space, which was traditionally up in one of those kind of graded classes. And one more, maybe it's a game console. I got into programming project like this. I got into programming to write games at BBC Micro. I wanted to write computer games. My first two startups were game companies. My conception of Raspberry Pi was not as a hardware hacking platform, which is really what it's become, but it would be a platform for young people to write computer games on. I was actually quite resistant, to putting GPIO pins onto Raspberry Pi at all, because I couldn't see how that was going to help people write computer games. And so I do still love it. I love it when people use Raspberry Pi products, whether it's a big Raspberry Pi or RP2040. I love it when people use our products. And this is probably quite a place. I'm cheating here slightly. This Doom port was done by Graham Sanderson, who's also the person who's responsible for the Pico SDK. It really is a technical tour de force. It's what's beautiful about it is it's changing the optimization target of the Doom engine. The Doom engine, I guess, is optimized to spend memory in order to save processing power, which if you have a 33 megahertz 486, that's absolutely the right thing to do. We have rather more processing power, but we have rather less memory. So what he's kind of done is to take the game engine and turn it inside out so that it prioritizes saving memory at all costs, even if that involves spending more time. It's kind of wonderful that Graham, who's responsible for the Pico SDK, we've kind of made a puzzle box. RP2040 is a puzzle box, and it's a sufficiently compelling puzzle box that even if you've been sitting there all day working on the Pico SDK, you still come back to it in the evening. So then you have it. That was the past and the present of RP2040. What about the future? Well, we've been in the market 2.5 years. We've sold nearly 10 million RP2040s to decodes. We got a pretty good idea of what people love about RP2040 and some of the stuff I've seen here over the last day. So these new ideas for things that people love about RP2040. But we've also got a pretty good idea about what they don't want. Those codecs and zeros. We lack hardware floating point. We lack DSP instructions, we lack other ARMv8M functionality. Moving to a more modern ARM core like M4 or M33 might open up new opportunities to run even higher performance workloads on the platform. The 7x7 QFN package that we have and our 30 GPIOs, I think that hits a pretty popular sweet spot in the middle of people's demand for microcontrollers, but we do meet people who either would like a smaller form factor or people who would like more GPIOs. Finding ways to cater to those people might be an interesting thing to do in the future. We don't have a secure environment. We don't really have any by design. We don't have any security features of RP2040. We don't have the ability to store secrets, to store keys or other secrets, or perform secure computation on the device. And that means that it's a great fit. It's a great fit for IoT applications. And if you want to perform some of those attestation and cryptographic operations, you do need a companionship to do that. And finally, our lowest power, I will say, our lowest power idle state in RP2040 is, by design, not very low. The lowest power state we can get in RP2040 and 2, while it's still incredibly happy now. I've been learning my engineering team for 2 years on redesigning our core products continuously to keep them in some degree of production during the supply chain crisis. Now that's behind us, I'm happy that we can start to devote some engineering effort to try to address some of these issues. And on the software side, we're going to continue to add features to the SDK. We're going to continue improving the development experience on Windows, which I think was not strong, certainly for the first year of 2040. And we're going to add support for more of these professional development environments, including IAR and Carl Studio. It really has been a privilege, actually, to support the community with a very consistent supply of 2014 during a period of time when we are a general purpose computing company. One way or another, almost everything you make is either a general purpose computer or supports a general purpose computer. Just as the community took the Raspberry Pi computer to unimaginable places a decade ago, today I think the community is finding incredible new uses for our Raspberry Pi silicon. If you'd like to let us know what you've been doing with RP2040, or you want to experience RP2040 for the first time, you can find us on the dairy base stand down near the entrance for the rest of the day. We've had a real blast developing RP2040, and I can assure you we're not done yet. With that, I'd like to thank you for your time, and maybe you can take one or two questions.